In the previous lecture, we got done with discussing the model of a parallel machine. And in this lesson, what we're going to start doing is talking about synchronization algorithms that goes into the guts of any parallel operating systems that is supporting multi-threaded applications. And as we discuss these synchronization algorithms, watch out for Thacker's quote that I mentioned in the previous lesson on sharing in shared memory multiprocessors. That is going to be very, very key in terms of understanding the scalability of the synchronization algorithms. Synchronization primitives are a key for parallel programming. In your first project, you implemented a threads library which provides the mutual exclusion lock. Let's talk about locks. What exactly is a lock? Well, you know, in the metaphor that you know about in real life, lock is something that protects something that is precious. And in the context of parallel programming, if you have multiple threads executing and they share some data structure, it is important that the threads don't mess up each other's work. And a lock is something that allows a thread to make sure that when it is accessing some particular piece of shared data, it is not being interfered with by some other thread. That's the purpose of a lock. So the idea would be that a thread would acquire a lock, and once it acquires the lock, it knows that it can access this data that it shares with potentially other threads. I'm showing only two threads here, but potentially in a multi-threaded program, you can have a lot more threads that are sharing a data structure. And once T1 knows that it has access to this data structure, then it can do whatever it wants with it. And then once it is done with whatever it wants to do with this data, it can release the lock. So that's sort of the idea behind a lock. And locks come in two flavors. One is what we'll call an exclusive lock or a mutual exclusion lock. And this is exactly the one that you implemented in your first project. And the idea is, as the name suggests, a mutually exclusive lock means that it can be used by one thread at a time. That's the idea. And here is a silly example of two children playing, and you know, they had to take turns in order to hit this ball. And obviously, you don't want both of them hitting the ball at the same time. Not good for the game, and not good for the safety of the children either. That's the same thing that applies to the mutual exclusion lock that we use in parallel programming. The idea is that a thread that wants to modify data, it has to make sure that when it is modifying the data, nobody else is going to be accessing that particular data structure, and therefore it is going to get a mutual exclusion lock. It knows that nobody else is going to be messing with it. Then it can modify the data and then release the lock. And similarly, if another thread wants to read the data and wants the assurance that nobody is going to be modifying this data while it is reading it, it can get an exclusive lock, access the data, read it, and then release it. That's the idea behind mutually exclusive lock. You can also have a shared lock. Now, what that means is that this lock is something that allows multiple threads to access the data at the same time. Well, under what conditions would that be meaningful? Well, here is an analogy again. If there's a newspaper and multiple people want to read the newspaper at the same time, perfectly fine to do that, right? That's the same sort of thing that happens often in parallel programming, that you have a database and there are records in the database that multiple threads want to inspect, but they want to make sure that while they're inspecting it, the data itself is not going to be changed. So a shared lock is something that allows multiple readers to access some data with the assurance that nobody else is going to be modifying the data. So these are two different types of locks that you might have that might be useful in developing multi-threaded shared memory programs.